Watkins Band, has been conducted the last day and a half by another wonderful musician, teacher, conductor, Mr. Alfred Watkins. I had the pleasure of working with Alfred when I was 20 years old and a recent graduate of Furman University. My first job was as the assistant band director at Lassiter High School with Alfred Watkins as my mentor. And so I went from Jay Bill Cook and Dan Ellis, who were wonderful mentors here at Furman, right to an assistant band director position where there was someone who taught me everything that he knew and treated me as an equal and really helped to lift me up as a young, and I said 20, I literally was 20 years old when I graduated from college, and I was too young and dumb to know that I was young and dumb. So Alfred was just very significant in helping to shape and mold me as a teacher, and I say anything decent that I might do as a band director is to his credit, because I learned by watching him. And the students this weekend had a really wonderful opportunity to work with him and have some insight into Alfred, his work, and his musicianship, and his personality. So I really believe when we have host honor band events like this, it's the people that stand up on the podium that work those 6-7 hours of rehearsal with the students that make or break it. And so I will only hire people who I absolutely have no doubts about, 100% I know that the students are going to gain a lot from and take what they learn home to their home band programs, because that's really what it's all about. We want the students to come here, learn something, gain something, and then take it home and spread the wealth, spread the knowledge. And so that's the kind of experience that Mr. Gilreath obviously provided with the earlier band, who did a great job, by the way, and this band that you'll hear on the stage as well. So without any further discourse from me, please welcome the Watkins Band and their conductor, Mr. Alfred Watkins.
Thank you. Thank you so much. No, I've known Mevo since he was this tall. Good friend. Thanks for coming out. I hope you enjoyed the first piece. James Turner's Big Band Flourishes. Started off with a big band there. Kind of a Baroque Renaissance segment in the middle. And it goes back to fanfare. The second piece, the third piece, will bear a bit of identification and some idea as to how it's composed. Now, in the classical music world, is our custom. The conductor to come to the stage and the ensemble to stand and the audience to greet us, and we don't say anything, and we become a museum piece. You look at us and try to figure out what we're playing, and you clap at the end. That worked for centuries in Europe. Doesn't work quite as well when we're playing for audiences that come and see their children and grandchildren, aunts and uncles play, the ones that truly love them, in addition to a university setting. So, pardon me for having some conversation tonight with regards to the pieces. First off, would you join me in congratulating Leslie Gilreed on his new piece, Pieces of Glass? I thought it was just a terrific piece.
Kind of sound like Top Gun. Judy wrote that.
So whenever you watch an award show, Emmys, the Oscars, the Grammys, and the Tonys, and you hear a person that comes on stage, and some music kind of introduced to them, they sound like that person. Julie probably wrote it. She was a ghostwriter, which meant that she had to go off on the side and go to the room and write 45 seconds of music for this show because Clint Eastwood is going to come to the Oscars. And Julie goes over and writes it real fast and passes it out to the orchestra that Bill Conti's conducting. So that's her personality. So she writes pieces for causes, and this one is for innocence. Perhaps the innocence of youth, the innocence of a child, the innocence of an adult. Sometimes we're a little afraid. And just the innocence of going through life, not so sure what tomorrow is going to bring. To the students in the band, it doesn't only affect you. We all share the same innocence and the same kind of fears. So this is a hymn for us, those of us that are not quite so sure what tomorrow will bring. We try to engage it with a smile. She wrote a tune for all of us. So hope you enjoy the hymn for the innocence.
Thank you.
grandparent, as many of you are, actually my grandparent now, that's about a year ago. And I too worried about my sons. Do they listen to all this music that I call just pure divine garbage? But you just about can't say that to them, because the more you say it's garbage to them, the more they, you know, they're attracted to it. So I want them to make them be like decent with all that stuff that was going into those precious ears. But I forgot they were in this new land. And so I stopped worrying about them. So grandparents and parents, when they put their headphones on, they listen to music that we just absolutely hate listening to. We can't find rhyme or reason why any civilized person would listen to that music. Our parents said the same exact thing about us. So they're going to be fine. When you hear them play something as beautiful as the band, the second go play the program, and they play this lovely piece in about 2 hours, maybe an hour and a half. That means that they have those sounds and motions in their oral vocabulary before we even get them as conductors. I'd like to put a message into all of you. I go back to Furman to the days of Dan Ellis, as we affectionately in the business called him Daddy Dan. And Dan Ellis is one of those guys that had he not come through Furman, I'm not sure the band would have made it over half a century ago. There were others in the choral piano division and others in jazz that did as well. But in the band world, it was Daddy Dan that stood on the wall and monitored everything. So with the linkages that you have between Daddy Dan and Jay and Les Hicken, and then now with the young, almost 20-year-old Sue Samuels, I think the program's in good shape. You'll have to support her while she's here. She's rather fearless. They probably told her not to do this honor band because no one would show up for the first year. Well, I came. And then they came. And 200 kids came. And there's a concert. And it's pretty darn good. So she's not going to stop. She's going to continue to work and to build upon what Jay and Daddy Dan and Les put here. And the program's in good hands. So whenever something is, so that this part of South Carolina can be recognized for the fine arts as it has been forever. She'll just stand on top of the hill and yell it out. She'll just say, y'all come. And other things will happen as things evolve. So I'm very excited what's happening in my adopted community of Greenville and Furman. And I'm glad to see you all protecting the interest of the fine arts in this community. This beautiful McAlister Hall is a perfect example of a protection of the arts. And I have the pleasure of going around the country doing a lot of band like this, and it don't happen everywhere. Some places let the arts go for the sake of the STEM programs. That's their prerogative in the community. But it looks like Furman is in good hands and a good love of the arts here in the community. The last piece is, I'll describe it in 20 seconds. Gustav Holst wrote this piece. He also famous for a piece called The Planets. You know anything about classical music, you've heard Mars and Jupiter from The Planets. You know a lot of other pieces. Well, around the turn of the century, the old one, around early 2000s, early 1900s, there was not much written for the modern concert band. And Gustav Holst said they were boring. He played the trombone. And he said, well, I've got to step over from the orchestral side and give the band people some love over 100 years ago. And his sweet meat flat, he wrote two of them, sweet meat flat for military bands, we were called at the time. And so they're lovely melodies. This first movement was a chaconne. The tune was before we laid the melody out. We played all the way through. That's about 3.5 minutes. But you'll be able to follow the tune. And now he's decorated the melodies and the kind of melodies around it. But you'll always hear the chaconne. In the middle, he turns it upside down. And then it comes back to right side up. So that's the first movement. And the last movement is a march. Now, as soon as a march, it's going to be marching. But I draw your interest to the middle of the march from the Brit, Gustav Holst. Now, some of the students today, they have a slightly different tradition in their country than we do here. They'll stop for tea in the early afternoon. We'll have a Coke and a smile. But they stop for tea. They just want a cafe in Russia, like we do. But they call it tea time. But then when someone in royalty gets married, they call it a big deal. A big deal. So the middle of it is when you get the middle of the last movement, altitude two, they're 3 minutes each. And you'll hear the hymn coming off, a little anthem, a little melody. We just feel it reminds you of Buckingham Palace. And one of the people royalty getting married with this gigantically long train that they always like to have. And it just happened a few years ago. And so it puts you in the mind of that, and it ends up as a military march. So it's a two-movement work, a chaconne, which is one melody that kind of goes all the way through the movement, and a march with the weddings in the middle of it. So we hope you enjoy the first week of the class, first and last minute. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you so much for inviting me.
Thank you. right.
That's where that happens.
I'll send it to you.
Where do I send it?
What are you doing over there? You know, it's the darndest thing because I have like now 5 packs of CDs. So you don't have to spring them there.